Hello, and this is Brother Rudy Davis, and welcome into my home. I am standing in my den along with my pretty wife, sweet Linda, and my son and my favorite granddaughter. And I'm honored to be the regular supply preacher for the Yorktown First Baptist Church. And the Yorktown First Baptist Church, we are not assembling in our building for normal services right now. We're in cooperation with the governor of the state of Arkansas and the president of the United States. So we decided that we wanted to provide an alternative way in which the members of our church and our friends could share a worship experience. So we are providing this message from God's Word this morning so that you can share in this worship time. Now, just for your information, we are pre-recording this message right now, and it's Thursday. But it will be on my Facebook page. That's Rudy Davis Facebook page. And it will be on my Facebook page. It'll be posted there on Sunday morning about church time. Now, if it's inconvenient for you to view this message at your regular church time, then please be advised that the video will be on my Facebook page all day Sunday, so you can tune in at whatever time is convenient for you. Our goal here is to worship the Lord. Our goal here is to provide this worship experience for all those who cannot be in their local church. It's my prayer that our technology doesn't make it so difficult and interferes with the preaching of God's Word. Now, with all that having been said, let's just get to it. So, let me just ask you if you would, if you have your Bible there. Hopefully you have your Bible with you right now, or your electronic device, and hopefully you've got a piece of paper and a pencil, and you might can take some notes. But if you would, take your Bible or your electronic device and turn with me to Psalm 37, verse 1. Let me repeat that for you. That's Psalm 37, verse 1. Now, while you're finding this passage, Psalm 37, verse 1, while you're finding that passage, just let me remind you that what we're attempting to do here is to worship the Lord and by looking into His Word. So, if you found Psalm 37, verse 1, I'm going to read verse 1 through verse 11. Verse 1 begins like this. Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity. For they shall soon be cut down like the grass, and wither as the green herb. Trust in the Lord, and do good. So shalt thou dwell in the land, and verily thou shalt be fed. Delight thyself also in the Lord, and He shall give thee the desires of thine heart. Commit thy way unto the Lord, trust also in Him, and He shall bring it to pass. And He shall bring forth thy righteousness as the light, and thy judgment as the noonday. Rest in the Lord, and wait patiently for Him. Fret not thyself because of him who prospereth in his way, because of the man who bringeth wicked devices to pass. Cease from anger, and forsake wrath. Fret not thyself in any wise to do evil. For evildoers shall be cut off, but those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth. For yet a little while, and the wicked shall not be. Yea, thou shalt diligently consider his place, and it shall not be. But the meek shall inherit the earth, and shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. Right now in our world, things are just in a mess. Many people are ill right now, and tragically, some have passed away. Economically, many of our people are suffering right now. They need money to live on, but they don't have a job because businesses are closed. Now, our president the other day, I was watching him on a news show, and our president called this coronavirus, he referred to it as an unseen enemy. And when he said that, I thought about that for a moment. And this particular psalm, Psalm 37, is written by David. And David writes this psalm, and he addresses the subject of when it seems like evil is prospering and good is not. And so what I'd like to do is I'd like to take this psalm, and I really believe that David wrote it for two purposes. I think he wrote it for the purpose of encouragement. I also think he wrote it for the purpose of instruction. And I think with this unseen enemy that seems to be prospering in our world right now, we need a renewed confidence in God. So if you're one of those who like and appreciate titles to sermons, then that would be the title that I would put on this sermon, and that would be Confidence in God. And this is a time when we need that confidence in God. So as we look at what David says in these 11 verses, these 11 verses can easily be divided into three parts. Now, it's three unequal parts, but we are going to try to look at these three parts. And the first part is what I call a negative admonition. And then the second part is a positive admonition. And then the last part will be a powerful assurance. Now, it's my hope that you're still watching and you're still awake when we get to that last one. I think that's the one that I want to emphasize the most. But let's begin looking at these verses as we look at this negative admonition. And this particular section can be divided into two parts. The first of these is the challenge that is given in verse 1. And this challenge in verse 1, David says this, "Fret not thyself because of evildoers, neither be thou envious against the workers of iniquity." I zeroed in on that word, on that phrase, "Fret not thyself because of evildoers." And as I was preparing this message and as I was looking at that phrase, you know, the word fret there has always meant to me to worry about something. And so I looked it up in about four or five different translations, and every translation that I looked at all use the same word, and that is that word fret. And I said to myself, so what David is saying here is don't worry because of this evil that has come upon us, this unseen enemy that has come upon us. It just simply means don't worry about that. But I didn't trust my own understanding. So what I did was I went to the Hebrew language and I looked up this word and I wanted to know for sure what that word fret meant. And the truth of the matter is the word fret here does not mean to worry. The word fret here means to be angry. In fact, the root word to this word fret means to be hot. So in essence, what David is saying here is don't be hot with anger with this unseen enemy. And when I read that and when I understood that, it kind of puzzled me as to why David would say that. But then I began to think to myself, you know, when things go bad, we do have a tendency just to get mad. We want to blame somebody. In this case, with this virus that we're dealing with, we might want to blame China. That's where the virus originated, was in China, and we might want to just get mad at China, or we might want to get mad at government. Maybe we're saying, well, the government's just not doing enough, or what they're doing, they're not doing right. And we might want to just get angry about that. Or perhaps, now I know some of you may have trouble dealing with this, but perhaps you might just get angry with God. And you might say, well, God, you could have prevented this. You have the power to stop this virus right in its tracks. You had the power for it not to exist at all. So maybe we want to get mad at God. Now, I know some of you are thinking, well, you're not supposed to get mad at God. And you're right, you're not supposed to get mad at God. But sometimes we do. And then it's possible that we might just get mad at ourselves. You know, we might say, well, you know, if I'd have been more careful, if I'd have just listened to what the medical experts were telling me, maybe I wouldn't be in this situation I'm in right now, and I'm mad at myself because I didn't make good choices. Well, now listen to me and listen to me carefully. That's not what you want to do right now. David makes it very, very clear here that we are not to fret ourselves because of this evil that has come upon us. We're not to get mad at anybody. If we get mad at anybody, we're going to wind up being mad at everybody. And let me tell you a little secret between us, and that is, it's not going to help anything. But not only do we have this challenge, we also have here a confidence that is given in verse 2. And in verse 2 it says, for they, that would be the evil, for they soon shall be cut down like grass and wither as the green herbs. Now let me just briefly condense my words here about this phrase and just say this. This too shall pass. This is not going to last forever. We are in a difficult situation. More difficult for some than others, but we are in a difficult situation. But fear not, worry not, be not angry. This too shall pass. It will come to an end. The Lord has given us that confidence, that assurance. So that is the negative admonition. But then secondly in this psalm, and this will be the biggest piece of the message, secondly in this psalm, we not only see this negative admonition, but there is a positive admonition. Really, there are four positive admonitions in these 11 verses. And I just want to take one of them at a time and just walk through these positive admonitions. Now, this is what David is saying. David is saying, as you are not angry, then hear positively, this is what we ought to be doing in the midst of this difficult time. Now, the first one appears in verse 3. So if you've still got your Bible open, you can look at verse 3. And in verse 3, the first few words or the first phrase in this verse simply says, trust in the Lord. Now the word trust here is a word which means to completely place one's confidence in. So what David is saying here is, even though we don't have all the answers, even though we don't know exactly everything that's happening, we need to put our confidence willingly and completely in the Lord. May I ask you a rhetorical question? May I ask you, in whom are you putting your trust? I mentioned earlier that I'd watched some news about this on TV. I have come to the point that I'm not watching the news about this situation as much as I have been, simply because it has a tendency to bring me down emotionally, and I don't need that right now. But let me just ask you again, who is it in this difficult time? Who is it that you are putting your confidence in? Are you putting your confidence in these medical professionals that are doing everything? And by the way, I think they're doing a good job. I'm not complaining at all. But are you putting your confidence in these medical professionals that are doing everything they can to lessen the effect of this virus and to come up with some kind of a vaccine, some kind of an inoculation against this virus? Is that where you're placing your confidence in medical science of man? Is that your point of confidence? I hope not. Are you putting your confidence in the government? Perhaps you're thinking, well, you know, if the president and if these governors and if these mayors and if the government just does enough, then everything's going to be all right. Is that where you're placing your confidence? Well, I hope not. Because you see, David says here, put your confidence in the Lord. Now that doesn't mean that I'm speaking evil or I'm speaking bad about the government or the practice of medicine. That just means that I know there's somebody who's bigger than they are. I know there's somebody who's more powerful than they are. And I know there is somebody that deserves for me to put my confidence in Him more than anything or anyone else. And that one point of confidence is none other than our Lord. Perhaps as much as any time in our life, perhaps even more, right now, we need to put our confidence in the Lord. Trust in the Lord. And by the way, David also includes here that when we put our trust in the Lord, it's a sure thing that He will take care of us. Secondly, not only does David admonish us positively here that we should trust the Lord, but it also, in verse 4, David says, in addition to trusting in the Lord, he says this. He says, delight thyself also in the Lord. Now, to delight oneself in the Lord simply means this. Now, listen to me carefully. It means this. Let the Lord be the source of your joy. If you are looking around you, And in this situation, if you are focusing on the virus, and if you're focusing on the problems that this virus is presenting to us, then you're going to lose joy. You're going to become depressed. You're going to become discouraged. So David says, don't let that happen. David says, let the joy that'll be in your heart, let it come because you have delighted yourself in the Lord. the source of your joy, the delight of your life, is none other than the Lord. You know, when you contemplate how many have been ill and how many have died from this virus, it just really strips the joy out of you. But when you concentrate on how good God has been to us, when you concentrate upon the beauty, and when you concentrate upon the grace, and when you concentrate upon the love that God gives us, it just brings joy to our heart, even though we're in the midst of a difficult situation. So David says, number one, he says, trust the Lord. But number two, then he says there's something more we must do, and that is delight in the Lord. Let the Lord be a source of joy. I was reading somebody on Facebook just here recently, and they were talking about being confined to their home and not being able to go out. And they were talking about how they were thinking maybe they were just going to lose their mind. Well, if in these times that we are at home, we delight in the Lord, the result will be this time will be filled with joy. Delight in the Lord. And then thirdly, not only does David say, trust in the Lord and delight thyself in the Lord, but David also in verse 5, he says, commit thy way unto the Lord. Now, here again, just like that word fret that I mentioned earlier, I had to study that word a little bit deeper than normal. And when I did, I found out that I didn't understand that word as well as I thought. When I came to this word commit, and when I pondered and when I meditated upon what God was trying to tell me through David, as David says, commit thy way unto the Lord, I said to the Lord, Lord, if I'm going to understand what you're asking here, what you're instructing me to do, I've got to know more about that word commit. So I went to the Hebrew and I looked it up and I studied it, and wow, did I make a discovery. That word commit, literally, watch my hands now if you can see them on the cameras. That word commit literally means to roll, that's R-O-L-L, to roll over. What David is saying here is roll over thy way. Now what's your way? Well, your way is your life. So David is saying roll over thy way or your life unto the Lord. And I began to pray and I began to ask the Lord, Lord, how do I convey to folks that will be listening to this, how do I convey to them what it means, what you're talking about when you say roll over your life to the Lord? And I tell you what I thought about. I thought about times when my children were babies. And I thought about times when my children had babies, my grandbabies. And I thought about how when you hold a baby, you take that baby in your arms and you roll that baby's face towards you. And you protect and hold that baby with that baby's face toward you. But then when someone else wants to hold that baby, when somebody else comes up to you and says, you've held him long enough, it's my turn. And when you give them that baby, watch my hands now if you can see it on the camera. You take and you roll that baby away from you and you roll it into the hands of the other. And then they take it and turn that face toward them. And when I pictured that in my mind, I pictured what God is saying here. When God says, commit thy way unto the Lord, He's saying, take your life and roll it over to me. Let me take that life into my hands. Now listen carefully to what I'm about to say. In order for us to commit our way or commit our life unto the Lord, that means we've got to roll it over, our lives, roll them over to Him. Now watch me, and then take our hands off of it. You see, folks, that's something we have trouble with. We seem to understand how to pray about difficult situations in our life. And we seem to want to trust these situations to the Lord. But sometimes what we want to do is we want to do both. We want to trust the Lord with this, but we also want to keep this situation in our hands too. And David says, you can't do that. What you need to do is not just trust the Lord, but you need to commit thy way to the Lord. Not just have a confidence that God can be trusted and be confident in Him, but also take our hands completely off of the situation and let it be in the hands of God. Totally and completely. I really believe that phrase there in verse 3 that says, trust the Lord. And this phrase here in verse 5 that says, commit thy way unto the Lord. I think they are related. I think what David is saying, what God is saying through David to us is, I want you to trust me. I want your confidence to be in me. But I also want you to take your hands off of it. And let me do it. Let me take care of it. Let me give you peace in a time when all around you there is no peace. Let me keep you well when all around you there are people who are not well. Look at me. Please understand what I'm saying. Don't try to do it on your own. And God doesn't need your help. Just commit it. Commit your whole life to the Lord. And He will take your life and He will bless it. And now fourthly, not only does David instruct us here in these positive admonitions to trust the Lord and delight thyself in the Lord and commit thy way unto the Lord, but then David also says this, and this is in verse 7. And in verse 7, David says this. He says, rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. Rest in the Lord and wait patiently for Him. What's it mean to rest? Well, the word rest has many applications in the English language. But let me say this, the word rest here, the definition of the word rest here, the best definition I can give you for it is this. It simply means be quiet. Some of the translations I looked at use the phrase be still. I think that's all right. But the best definition for this word is to be quiet. Now, that I understand that could mean be quiet audially, and it also could mean be quiet in the sense of being still. But either application applies here, because what he's saying is simply, after you have trusted me, after you have let me be the source of your joy, and after you have rolled your life into my hands, be quiet. And then the second phrase in this is wait patiently. Boy, was I surprised when I studied that phrase. Wait patiently. Those two words, wait patiently, are translated from one Hebrew word. And the Hebrew word simply means to dance. Now, I'll be honest with you, I never put waiting patiently and dancing together before in my life. So I double check this to be sure this is what God is saying. On one hand, He's saying, be quiet, be still even perhaps. But then on the other hand, He's using a word which means to dance. And I said, Lord, how do I put these together? And the strong indication that came to my mind when pondering this and praying about this, listen carefully to me now, is this. Be quiet. God doesn't need your advice. You've turned it over to the Lord. Now be quiet. But listen to me. Don't be quiet in the sense that you're sulking. Don't be quiet in the sense that you're just sitting in the corner. But when you rest and be quiet in the Lord, listen to me, do it rejoicing. Dancing is an expression of joy. Do it rejoicing. Look at me. Anticipating that God is going to keep His word. And God is going to take care of your situation. The evil that has beset you will, in fact, as verse 9 says, will, in fact, be cut off. Now, let me see if I can put all that together. I may not do it well, but I'm going to see if I can put all four of these together into one progression of thought. In our situation where evil seems to be winning, where this unseen enemy has attacked us, what God instructs us to do here is, number one, trust Him. Be confident in Him. Number two, delight yourself in Him, which means to let Him give you joy even in the midst of this situation. And then roll your life over into the hands of God, and then take your hands off of it and just be quiet. But as you're being quiet, rejoice in your heart that God is still on the throne. God is still in control. And there is light at the end of this tunnel. That's what we're to be doing right now. Now I want to finish this up by looking at the very last part of these 11 verses. And in verses 9 through 11, and I'm going to move very quickly in this particular section. In verses 9 through 11, there is this positive assurance. I want to look first, if I could, at verse 9. And verse 9 says this, it says, "For the evildoers shall be cut off," but then, listen carefully to what he says, it says, "But those that wait," that's us, we are resting in the Lord and waiting patiently. It says, "But those that wait upon the Lord, they shall inherit the earth." It seems like a virus is in control of our world right now. But what God is saying here is when we wait upon the Lord, that He will return our world back to us. And then He says, look at verse 11, and I love this, and I'm glad that this comes at the end where the conclusion would be. In verse 11 it says, "But the meek." What does meek mean? Meek means those who are in control, self-control. "But the meek," those who are in self-control, those who are trusting the Lord, those who are delighting in the Lord, those who are committing their way to the Lord, those who are resting in the Lord and waiting patiently for Him. This group, the meek, what does it say about the meek? "But the meek shall inherit the earth." Now listen to this part. This is a good part. "And shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace." They shall delight themselves in the abundance of peace. Dear brothers and sisters, we're in difficult times. We're in a difficult situation. I don't like it, not being a symbol even for church. I don't like it that people are sick. I don't like it that so many are dying. I don't like any of this. And I don't like that we're fighting an enemy that we can't even see. I don't like it. But God says here in His Word, negatively, don't be angry. Nothing positive is going to come from being angry. But instead, trust me. Delight in me. Commit your way to me. And having done all that, rest. Be quiet. And wait patiently. Because if you wait patiently, I'm going to give you something that the world can't give you. I'm going to give you an abundance of peace. Now that word abundance means filled to the point of overflowing. God says, as we go through these difficult days, follow His instruction. And be encouraged that in His time, this will be over. And He will replace it with an abundance of peace. I want to read Matthew chapter 6. I want to start at verse 25. And then I want to skip over and read a portion of verses 33 and 34. And this is what God says in Matthew chapter 6. He says, "Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, but seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness. And all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for the morrow, for the morrow shall take thought for the things of itself. Seek ye first the kingdom of God by trusting Him, delighting in Him, committing your way to Him, resting in Him. And whatever your needs are, God will see to it that they are met. Let's pray. Father, as we bow before you now, Lord, we thank you for the power and for the clarity of your word. And Lord, we are in a difficult situation. We are facing an unseen enemy, and on many fronts it looks like he may be winning. But Lord, help us to be encouraged that he's not winning, and he's not going to win. Lord, help us to fret not, to not be angry. Not be angry with China, not be angry with the government, not be angry with ourselves, not be angry with one another. But instead, help us, Lord, to trust you, to delight in you, to commit our way to you, and rest in you with rejoicing in our heart. That you might fill our lives with the abundance of peace. Now, Lord, I have no idea who's watching, but I pray what's been said this morning has been both instructive and an encouragement. But, Lord, may I say, Lord, we love you and we thank you that we do have you to turn to in times like these. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Before we shut off, let me just encourage you. If you are a member of the Yorktown First Baptist Church, or if you're a friend of the First Baptist Church, let me encourage you. Stay in touch with one another. Check on one another. Love one another. We cannot allow this inability to gather and assemble. We cannot allow it to divide us. And I encourage all of you that are watching, don't get comfortable worshiping the Lord in front of a cell phone or a laptop or a TV screen. And just remember, when all of this is over, God's word clearly says, forsake not the assembly of yourself together. And when this is over, we all need to get back in church where we belong. Thank you. God bless you. You folks at Yorktown, remember, sweet Linda and I, we love you. Looking forward to seeing you real soon.